Hi, this is Jeff Ginter with Real Progressives. Welcome back to MMT Mondays. I hope you've enjoyed what we've been doing so far, showing you the experts, showing you where you can really begin to absorb this knowledge for yourself and to really start to uncover the lies that we have been told our entire lives about how the economy actually works. We'd love to be able to give you single payer healthcare, but I'm sorry, it's just too expensive. The federal government can't afford it. But they always be able to afford wars. And then we get into the whole idea that those that buy into even that argument understand for themselves that yes, we can always afford the wars because we take all this money and we put it there. And because we put it there, there's nothing left over to go here. We spent everything on war. We didn't leave enough left over to pay for healthcare. But it doesn't work that way. That is not how the federal government of a monetarily sovereign currency operates. So today, we're going to be showing you Warren Mosler really explain the story of money and how it got to be here. What is money? At the end of this, I hope you're going to stick around. We're going to talk just for a few minutes more and really see if we can just get the brain going. See if we can put you into a new direction. We'll be back soon. Bye-bye.
I'm going to do something a little bit unusual. I'd like to yield 5 minutes of my time to Steve Larchick. Steve, would you be willing to do that introductory thing you did about the money famine? Not the rest of it, just the money famine part.
Oh, my God, yes.
Okay.
Which part?
Just where you started off. Right up to the money famine.
Oh, okay.
And what how it affected everybody. That was moving.
Okay. Intro. Well, thank you, Warren. That's one of the problems with doing it without notes is it's hard to recreate. But let's try this. It's so hard to persuade ordinary people of the very complex concepts here. I mean, to us, it's pretty simple. Or at least to Warren, it's pretty simple. But that's not our audience. You talk about the jury, the concept of the money famine. Well, part of explaining things is to articulate to people what's really happening in the world. We just had this nice lunch. We're all well fed, pretty happy. What we're missing is that what we're suffering in the United States right now is nothing short of a money famine. And this is what I called it. And it's not hyperbole to call a thing what it is. We have people who are not living paycheck to paycheck because they don't have a paycheck. We have people that have exhausted everything they have. The couples both are working. They've expended all their credit. They're maxed out on their credit cards. They should be enjoying the inheritance from their parents and grandparents, but that's all gone. The money that they had in equity in their homes has been lost. We have, as Steve pointed out just a few minutes ago, an epidemic crisis of suicide in this country. I looked it up and the only time we had more suicides in the United States was 1932. Is that really where we are? And I'd also add to my comments from before that we have an opioid crisis, which is really just suicide on the installment plan. So it's so easy to think intellectually and ivory tower-ish at conferences like these. What we're talking about is real people. We have those of us, in a famine. The king always eats. The nobility eat. The people that are supporting the king and nobility, they eat. The military eats. The clergy eats. And because they're eating, maybe they don't notice that the rest of the people are starving. We're, although we think we're pretty good people, we're not paying enough attention to the fact that there is a money famine. And I explained why I thought there was a money famine, but we need to do something about it, and we need to start articulating our case in language that the average person and the average congressperson can understand. Thank you.
Okay, so not to let an important teaching moment go by, I'm going to review, because you're the people who are going to be going out there trying to do this, and so what I'm going to do is review it one more time, what I think are the important points, and then we'll go through a few ways to do it. So you're going to get one last lecture and one last set of instruction here. So number one, the money, for me, the money story starts with the government trying to provision itself. Lots of money stories start in a lot of ways, but if you just think of it as always starting with the government trying to provision itself, and how does it do it? Okay, there are different ways to do it throughout history. One way is just to go out and take slaves. Okay, another way the British did, they provisioned their navy by going to bars late at night and hitting people over the heads and dragging them onto ships. It's called impressing sailors. We pretend to be more civilized, as I like to say, and we use a monetary system. So how does the government do it? So clean sheet of paper, what you do is you establish a tax, okay, in something payable in something that people don't have. Okay, so what you want to do is transfer resources from the private sector to the public sector. You want people who are out there doing whatever they're doing to suddenly be working for the government. You need soldiers, you need police, you need public health workers, you need people in education. How do you get these people out of the private sector into the public sector? First thing you do is you levy a tax. You need a tax liability, and it has to be coercive. And for this example, I'll just use a property tax. You put a tax on everybody's house, and you make it payable in your new unit of account, your thing, your tax credit, the thing that is used to pay the tax, the dollar, or the yen, or the euro. They're all tax credits. Okay. Now what's happened? You've created something. Okay. What's happened is you've created sellers of real goods and services who now need your tax credit, or they're going to lose their house. Right? You've created unemployment. People looking for paid work. Unemployment is not about people looking to volunteer at the American Cancer Society. It's about people looking for work because they need or want the money. Right? And the problem with government when you want to provision yourself is that there's no unemployment. No unemployment in terms of your currency. There might be people willing to work for other things, but not for your currency. You need unemployment in terms of your currency, people looking to earn your unit of account. So you levy a tax, now people need your unit of account. All these people show up looking for work. All those people are unemployed. You now hire the unemployed that your tax created, and they are now provisioning your government. You've got your soldiers and your public health workers and everything else that you want. Okay, that's where the story begins. So where do we get residual unemployment? It's because the government hasn't hired all of the people the tax caused to be unemployed. You wanted to hire, the United States government wants to hire 2 or 3 million people, it levies a $3.5 trillion tax, and all of a sudden there's 25 million unemployed or something like that. The tax was way too large for the number of people they actually wanted to hire. Okay, well, they only hired the 3 million or whatever they wanted, and they leave the other 20 or 25 million, whatever it is, unemployed. These are people who would show up for paid work if it was around. Now, you can argue whether that number is 15 million or 25 million. It's a big number. But the point is that they are there because the government put on a tax that was that for whatever reason was too large for the number of people they wanted to employ. And so now, you know, what are we going to do? We've made a mistake. Okay, we can either hire those people. We're just crediting their accounts with dollars. That's not a problem. But we don't want 20 or 25 million people in government. So we have to lower the tax so they can get back into the private sector. If we want more people in government, if we decide we need 2 million, 3 million more in public services, and a lot of people have had a lot of good ideas for more public services, and I have a lot of good ideas for more public services, okay, we can hire those, but we're not going to be hiring all of them because the taxes are a lot more powerful than spending. They create a lot more unemployed than that amount of spending will take out of the economy. All right? So then we have to make our fiscal adjustments, either increase public spending or lower taxes to get all these people, you know, employed. Now, if we don't want them all in the government, there's another 5, 10 million, whatever, and we want those people to go back into the private sector, how do we do that? We can lower taxes so that the private sector will have the, there'll be enough spending in the private sector, and spending drives employment, so they can then hire these people. Okay, but they won't, because they don't want to hire people who are unemployed. In that sense, by causing people to come unemployed, the government has damaged them. Not physically, maybe not even emotionally, but just in terms of their marketability, they've damaged them. Employers don't like to hire people who are unemployed. They want to hire people who are already working. They know they come in on time, they know they don't get in fights, they're clean, whatever. They'd rather hire people already working. So what we do is we establish a transition job for the purpose of promoting the transition from the public sector, unemployment, from the unemployment to private sector employment. Okay. Now, it's not that the private sector doesn't want these people or don't want to hire them. I mean, they might not, but it's they can't. Okay. That's the whole point of the tax, to create unemployed that can't be hired by the private sector. The private sector doesn't have the means to, because if they did, you wouldn't be able to have anybody working for you in the public sector. Okay. The whole point of the exercise is to force people coercively out of the private sector into the public sector. We forced out too many, more than we want to employ in the public sector. Okay. So then we have to lower the tax, allow for the aggregate demand to grow so that they have the wherewithal to hire these people, and then you have to put them in a transition jobs so that they can then get the higher paying jobs in the private sector. Okay. Now I say your alternative is to either hire them or lower the tax and they'll go back. Okay. Some people will say we should just have them all in the public sector. That's fine. I'm not arguing with that. But we're looking at a, you know, a country of 340 million people, 200 million voters. There might be people, you know, the political decision might be we want to hire some of them and then have the rest go back to the private sector. It might be a consensus in the country, we want them all to go back to the private sector. I'm allowing for all of that. You can allow for that when you talk to people. You're going to talk to people who are going to want all the unemployed to go in the private sector. You're going to talk to people who want all the unemployed to go in the public sector. We accommodate that. I mean, that's included in this whole exercise. So anyway, that's the way, you know, I started. And so the very purpose of taxation is to create unemployment. Okay, unemployment is always an unspent income story. People talk about robots. That's a productivity story. It's not an unemployment story. That will, productivity does not create unemployment. It's unspent income that creates unemployment. Productivity can create unspent income, which then creates unemployment. If a business replaces people with robots and profits go up and then they don't spend the profits, then you will have residual unemployment. Okay, but that's a good thing, because that means we can either lower taxes or increase public spending to offset the unspent income problem and then not have unemployment. So productivity increases if the money doesn't get spent, means we can all either have our taxes lowered or we can have additional public services. Okay, so it's not a bad thing. Productivity is always a good thing. The problem is that one of the main problems of this reverse understanding is they turn good things into bad things. They turn productivity increases, where we can just push one button and get everything done, into a bad thing, mass unemployment. It's a good thing if we can push one button and get everything done. We don't have to do that. We can do other things. Okay, but we have to make the fiscal adjustment to offset the unspent income that comes with any of these policies. Trade is the same way. I heard something earlier about the trade deficit is draining off all this spending, which is true. Well, what's the appropriate policy response? To allow unemployment and then try and create more unemployment and then force everybody's wages down to be more competitive to export more? You know, there's another option, and that's what we are. We are that other option, which makes infinitely more sense, which is you make a fiscal adjustment. You lower taxes or you increase public services, so now we have enough money to buy everything we produce domestically plus whatever the rest of the world wants to send us. That's what happened in 1999. We had unemployment under 4%. We had inflation under 2%. Not that that particularly mattered, but it tells you we weren't overheating. And we had record imports of $390 billion back when that was huge money. Okay, how did we do that? Well, we had enough money to spend on both everything we could produce domestically. We bought everything, kept unemployment down, plus whatever the rest of the world wanted to send us. Okay. Where did that income come from? We had lots of savings. It came from deficit spending. Okay, where was the deficit spending? It wasn't the government. Government was running a surplus of 2% of GDP. It was the private sector deficit spending. The private sector was deficit spending 7% of GDP, chasing these ridiculous business plans of all these dot-com companies, and then the whole Y2K thing where you had to change your computers or the world was going to end, right? But it was deficit spending, spending more than income, that was offsetting the savings desires. And it allowed us to have enough money to have full employment, reasonably speaking, you know, plus record imports at the same time. Okay, a trade deficit does not have to result in unemployment. That's the worst policy option. It's a good thing. It allows us to have lower taxes or more public spending to sustain full employment. Those are good things that happen. And it makes sense that a trade deficit would be a good thing. Okay, imports are real benefits. You get things. Exports are real costs. You have to give them to somebody else. Why would that be bad if you get more imports? You're getting more things. Well, it puts people out of work. That's because we got an unspent income problem. In this case, it's the foreigners who aren't spending the income. You lower taxes or you increase public spending, you make your fiscal adjustment, and a good thing becomes a better thing. You got full employment, better jobs, and all the imports. Okay, and it's always sustainable. It's never not sustainable. Okay. And then MMT is always prepared, at least I am, to answer the new questions that come up. And I know we talked about some of these the first night, but I think we got different people here. The latest thing coming up is that we've got this big debt over the low interest rate. I promoted a zero rate policy. I think that's the way to go. The government doesn't pay interest on the dollars it spends that haven't been collected for taxes, otherwise called the public debt. It promotes price stability, and we use fiscal adjustments to sustain aggregate demand instead of trying to fool with interest rates, which have massive distributional issues and all kinds of things. But the answer to that is, look, the low interest rates have caused debt to explode. And now we got a huge private sector debt overhang because of the low interest rates. Well, number one, we don't, because debt service as a percent of income is low. So in that sense, that's not the problem. There are lots of problems, but that's not one of them. But the low interest rate, you don't get any borrowing unless there's a saver. You can't borrow $20 from me unless I have $20 I don't want to spend. And if you borrow $20 from a bank, they've created new money, new bank deposits, there's still a saver. Or you can't do that, okay? It might be you. You might borrow the $20. Let's say you borrow $200,000 from the bank. You might be the saver. You might just stick it in your, leave it in your bank account. Fine, okay, you're the saver. But if you want to buy something with it, a house or a car, whoever you bought that from has to be the saver, because he'd rather have the money than the car, and then that when the day ends, he's got the $200,000. And if he buys something from somebody else has it. It doesn't disappear. So you can't go into debt unless you're the saver from yourself. But you can't go into debt unless there's a saver. So that whole debt overhang actually is driven by a gain in savings desires, which is entirely counterintuitive to most people. How could low interest rates create a stronger savings desire? Well, let's look at Japan. The highest public sector debt ratio in the world, 250%, and they've had zero rates for 30 years. It's created huge savings, have been associated with the zero rate penalty. So we see around the world that the association is there. And we know logically that causation is there, that it's the saver who's doing it. And so although it's counterintuitive, it's there in the data, it's there in the evidence. So I was saying this to a presentation at a group of pension fund money managers, and one of them asked me that. He said, well, I thought the lower interest rates would cause people to save less. So I said, okay, you're a pension manager. What do you do with your pension fund when interest rates come down? What happens to your contributions? He says, well, we have to put more in so we can get the same benefit at the end. I said, okay, you just answered your own question. You've got to save more for the end result if interest rates are lower. Well, how big a factor are our pension funds? Massive. Okay. Why are they there? Because we have tax-advantaged reasons to save. Government has decided to give you, to allow you to put pre-tax money into your pension fund, into your IRA. We're encouraging all this savings, right? Okay. When you encourage savings, what is that? That's a demand leakage. That's money, that's unspent income. That causes unemployment. Okay. And so what do you have to do to offset it? There has to be debt or there's going to be unemployment. So somebody has to spend more than their income. So it winds up being the public sector. So the people who are, the irony here is the people who are totally against public sector debt are the ones who are all in favor pushing hard for tax advantage savings. And they're creating the thing they're against. Not that they're right in either case. Well, why do they do this? Because they believe you need savings to have money for investment. When it's the other way around, investment creates the savings, loans create the deposits. So anyway, we're here to straighten these things out. If you get into any of these discussions, you know, send me an email or something. I do it all the time. I spend half my day helping people, you know, activists, get it straight. You can go up against anybody, you know, if you've got me on the other end of the wire. I don't care where they are. And immediately, they start yelling Zimbabwe and Weimar. Right? How many of you heard that? Okay. So what do you say about inflation? Well, first of all, you start with, there's different ways to start. And I just got to relay the story. I was on Fox Business News trying to push my payroll tax holiday in 2010. And anyway, Stuart Varney was interviewing me on, and you go watch it. I'm sure I'm not telling it exactly correctly. They wanted somebody on who was promoting big deficits. Krugman couldn't make it or something, so they got a hold of me. And so they put me on there. Somebody wanted a larger deficit. He said, oh, so you want a larger deficit? I said, yes, my proposal is for a $1 trillion tax cut. I want to eliminate FICA taxes. It's a highly regressive punishing tax. It would add $650 a month to every working family on average. And so they could make their mortgage payments, which would end the banking crisis. And he goes, oh, so you're one of those big government, big spending liberals. It's like, I just proposed, you know, I just put myself, you know, like 1,000 miles right of the Tea Party on this as far as they're concerned, and I'm a big spending liberal, right? So and the guy next to him goes, Stuart, you know, he said a tax cut. He goes, oh, okay, so I know who you're dealing with. This is a guy who's an astute business guy. So when you're dealing with people, they don't hear you. They're expecting something, and they just immediately yell Zimbabwe, even if you had said something highly deflationary, right? So, number one, MMT is the only valid explanation of inflation there is. And I mean one that actually, you know, there's no dispute about. And you don't have to give them this explanation, but the currency is a monopoly. You put a tax on, people come to work. You decide what they're going to get paid, whether it's $10 a day or $100 a day. You know, the government, all the congressmen think the government needs to get our money to be able to spend, but we know we need the government's money to be able to pay the tax, we collectively as the economy. We need their money, they've got it, that's a monopolist. Monopolists set price. They tell us the terms of exchange when they spend, whether they know it or not. The source of the price level can only come from that. There's nothing else left. You know there's nothing else. And when you don't think of that, when you haven't understood that it's a monopoly and the government's price, you come up with something called inflation expectations theory. And that's what they all rely on. And just so you know what it is, they have no idea where the price level came from, but they know what it is and what it's been. And therefore, the only way it can possibly change is if expectations change. And so they try and manage expectations. But it's a default position because they don't have anything else. And all their models show it's indeterminate. And so on inflation, we've got the only understanding of inflation. No one has any understanding of where the price level comes from or why it changes. We know it changes because the government changes what it pays when it spends. Now, it might be good policy to change what you pay and have a little inflation. It might not. But we know how it works, number one. Number two, what you're going to be promoting is the idea of the transition job or the job guarantee. And all you have to say is, look, right now we're using unemployment to control inflation. And but the problem is employers don't like to hire people who are unemployed. And so it doesn't do a good job of controlling inflation. We're using an employed buffer stock. We're using a job guarantee where all these people will be employed. They'll be a lot more attractive to employers in the private sector. It becomes a better device to control inflation, a better tool for inflation control. What we can say is having an employed buffer stock rather than unemployed provides superior price stability to what we have now. Okay, I can't tell you how much better, but it's obviously better. And every economist will agree that it's better because people can move better from unemployment to private sector employment. So you don't run out of labor and get labor bottlenecks and labor shortages when unemployment's still 10%, which is what happens in Europe all the time because they can't move these people. Okay, so all you have to say is, look, our proposal reduces inflation compared to what we have now. Okay, it's the old thing, you don't have to outrun the bear, I only have to outrun you, right? You know that story? Okay, what we're doing is comparing what we have to what we're proposing, and we're proposing superior price stability. And that you know, goes without saying. And so that will help you when somebody says, well, what about inflation? Well, yes, we're concerned also. And so what we're proposing provides better price stability. And we're not going to have fiscal adjustment to get that buffer stock to get the people in the job guarantee down to zero. We're going to keep it at 2 or 3% or some low number. And they're all working. And we'll get the same, we'll have better price stability than trying to get unemployment down that low because the people are working. Okay. I'd like to also let you know that what you're going out with has been subject to intense scrutiny for 25 years. Okay, when I take this and start talking to staff positions at the Federal Reserve Bank, the head of monetary affairs, you know it's getting a hard look. Vince Reinhart was head of monetary affairs for Greenspan and for Bernanke before he left for several years through the crisis. And, you know, he helped me write one of my speeches that I gave. Okay, so this has passed a lot of scrutiny. I've been all over the world with it. I've been on panels all over the world with economics professors from Italy, the United States, Spain, all places, you know, for a long time. And I don't think, and so is Randy and Stephanie and some others, but from my experience, I don't think, and I've been writing for a long time, soft currency economics, I don't think a single word has been refuted. I don't know, correct me if I'm wrong? Have you seen anything? No. Okay. And, you know, there have been people who have criticized it, but it's been, you know, not valid criticism. There basically hasn't been a word refuted. And it'd be pretty hard to do because I'm fairly careful when I do it to make sure I'm sticking to things that are beyond dispute, or I don't put them in there. And when I do talk about something that might be disputed, like I did this morning in that talk, I say it right away. Tell me if I'm wrong on this. I'm kicking this around. But this stuff that's down there, you know, you're going out with something that's been scrutinized by people at Federal Reserve, people at Treasury, finance ministers, and serious professors of economics and finance from all over. There's an important thing I'm going to tell you in a minute, and then I'll remind me to tell you how it started. But there are two sound bites that I gave to Stephanie a few years ago to help Bernie Sanders if he wanted to talk about the deficit. The first one was to, if anybody starts, there are only two things you need to answer to respond to questions about, well, that's going to add to the public debt, okay, the deficit. You say, well, look, the public debt is just the dollars spent by the government that haven't yet been used to pay taxes. And first of all, they don't know how to respond or anything, but that's what it is. It's just the dollars spent that haven't used to pay taxes. And they never heard that. And then you wait and you see what the next question is. And if you say, well, how do you pay it back? Well, you know, we've already spent it. Those are just the dollars we've spent that people have. They can use it to pay taxes or they can hang on to it. There are no other choices. Well, what about all those treasury bonds and everything? Those are the dollars we've spent that are in accounts at the Federal Reserve called treasury bonds. And if they want, they can move them to other accounts called reserves or they can have cash. But they just sit there in one of those, you know, as dollars spent that haven't been used to pay taxes. And until they want to use them to pay taxes, they're going to be out there forever in the private sector until somebody pays taxes with them. Okay, and then there's a few takeoffs on there. We'll practice this a little bit later. The other thing is, you know, look, if there's not, the only possible long-term deficit problem is an inflation problem, or short-term. Okay, the only only financial problem, that's what I should say, the only financial problem possible from a deficit is a inflation problem. Okay, and so if somebody's telling you this deficit spending is going to do this and that, you say, look, the only possible problem we could see from this deficit spending on entitlements, Social Security, so we have to cut it, the only possible problem is an inflation problem. Okay, you know, there's no other problem. We're not going to bounce checks. We're not going to default. Could be an inflation problem. That's the only possible problem. And right now, the CBO, the Fed, and the precious free market tips, treasury market, is forecasting between 1.75% and 2% in long-term inflation. And that's with no adjustments to entitlements. No, just everything exactly the way it is. The debt's going to be $77 trillion. Okay, fine. It's going to be a 2% inflation according to the Fed, the CBO, and the Treasury market. And so if you're telling me there's an entitlement problem now, the burden of proof is on you to show me those forecasts are wrong. All right, so who did I have this conversation with? A guy named Professor Michael Woodford. Does that ring a bell to anybody? Okay. He was voted the number one most influential mainstream economist for central bankers in the world. He's the one behind all the Jackson Hole stuff and the people, they run everything by him. So I had a conversation with him on the phone a couple of years ago. I say exactly that. I said, you know, one thing that concerns me is that the, you know, the headline, debit, securities accounts, credit reserve accounts. Remember that when you grow up. I said, look, the only possible problem you can get from deficit spending is financial problem is inflation. He goes, he takes about 3 seconds. He goes, yeah, of course, all the accounts clear at the Fed. That's not going to be a problem. I said, well, you know, with the long-term forecast now at 2% by the Fed, the CBO, and it was 1.75% by Treasury market, seems to me the burden of proof of somebody who's claiming we have an entitlement problem now is on them to prove that those inflation forecasts are wrong. He goes, yeah, you're absolutely right. I mean, there was no question, no pushback. And he was the number one mainstream economist in the world, financial economist for all the central banks. So you're safe going out with this. It's not, you're not going to lose this point. I don't want to send you out there vulnerable to getting hit with something you don't understand. All right, so what I want to do here to continue on this as part of your continuing education here is we'll come up with some of the questions you get that you might feel you don't have good soundbite answers for. So, for example, how are you going to pay for it? All right, and somebody says to me, how are you going to pay for it? And I say, well, we're going to credit the appropriate account at the central bank just like we do for all government spending. The only way government spends is to credit accounts. Now, they might not know what that means, but they know they got an answer to their question. It's a little like deposition. We don't want to say something that leads to something else that they might catch you out on. So you just say that, and then they say, well, don't you have to tax or something? It's like, no, that process is operationally independent. The guy taxing is changing numbers down at the Fed, and the guy spending is changing numbers up. They don't even have each other's phone number. And they don't, or email, whatever. Okay, and the guy buying in debt management, buying and selling bonds, is debiting and crediting securities accounts and reserve accounts. He doesn't talk to either of the other two. They don't know each other. They're in different buildings, different places. Okay, so they're operationally independent. They say, well, okay, now, you know, might you cause inflation or something like that? You say, yeah, that might be the only problem, but you ask me how we're going to pay for it. This is how we pay for it. Well, if you spend and don't tax, might you cause inflation? Yes. We might do that, but right now, you know, to get out of a hole, the first thing you got to do is stop digging. Our inflation's lower than the Federal Reserve wants. They're trying to find ways to drive it up. If we did that, they'd probably send us a nice letter thanking us for helping them meet their inflation target. You know, if you do too much, possibly, but you just ask me how you're going to pay for it. Okay, and so does anybody have questions like the how you're going to pay for it question that you'd like to have some more information on how to respond? Yeah.
Well, when we get them to understand that the federal taxes they pay don't actually fund what the government does.
Okay, but when you do that, well, let me stop.
The next question is, then why do I pay taxes?
Right. So you have to say the tax, you got to be careful. I don't ever say, even though it's not wrong, I will say the, you know, you need tax liabilities. The government needs to have tax liabilities to be able to spend. They need to.
They won't understand that.
No, but I'm telling you. I'm telling you. The government has to have tax liabilities. They don't need the actual money, but you have to have a tax. You have to need the money. Okay? So the government needs to have you need their money.
Right.
And that's why they tax. To create unemployment.
Yeah. I can still say, okay, I understand that. I understand you're telling me it drives currency and that's what gives it.
Yeah. And then you can say, Right. Now, if instead of, the government needs you to need their money, so they have to take, they have to put a hole in your pocket.
Right.
Okay? And so if you just took your money and threw it away, that would be okay. Then you wouldn't have to give it to the government. Okay, but they can't trust you to do that. You know, if you just went to the bank and changed your number down, you know, they'd be okay. But they can't trust you to do that. Take the money out, throw it away, we'll trust you. They can't do that. Okay, so it's a matter of enforcement. They have to make sure you need the money by taking it away from you. Okay, and so they put a tax on your house or a tax on your car, or an income tax doesn't drive the model so easily. It's more complicated, but it does the same thing at the end of the day. It's a debit on the economy, and that's why they have to tax imputed income. If you work for somebody else and you don't pay each other, they'll tax you anyway. So they have to do that, or the tax doesn't work. Okay, and so if they catch you. So I don't like to say that taxes don't fund spending, because the word fund is ambiguous, and even though you're right, you can be dead right. Okay, so it's better to say the government doesn't need your money to be able to spend. Okay, not that it doesn't fund it, it's that they don't need it to be able to spend. Okay, but they need you not to have it. They don't use it to spend, but they need you not to have it so that they can spend. They have to create a shortage to be able to spend. It's like you create a vacuum to be able to suck in the air. You have to create a shortage to be able to spend. And taxes are more powerful than spending. A tax of a dollar allows the government to spend maybe $1.25. Because if you're taxed, you need the money not only to pay tax, but you want to save some. Because taxation creates high anxiety in a lot of people, including Congress, who has anxiety about not having enough investment money, stupid as it is, and so they give you a tax advantage reason not to spend your money. But all these things conspire to make taxes more powerful than spending. So if they, you know, tax you a dollar, they might be able to spend $1.25. And I don't mean you, I mean the whole economy. Now, what develops later is that there are people with a lot of money, and taxing them is not powerful at all. It doesn't change their spending. Okay, you would tax them for social equity because it affects social relations, but not because it's going to give the government any fiscal space or create a need for money in the economy so that you could spend more. Okay, so does that help with?
I
hope. You know, well, try it and let me know.
Try that.
It's warren.mosler@gmail.com. Let me know how it works. Because, you know, all this kind of.
I'll have an email.
Yeah. How about yourself? Yeah.
I had two. One is Social Security is broke.
Yeah.
And why do the politicians on both sides of the aisle continue to say out loud that they can't afford things?
Yeah.
If that they believe that Obama is up here saying, you know, we need to tighten our belt and we need to reduce the debt. Why do they continue to say that?
Because it's my opinion, they believe it because you believe it. And they want to get elected.
You really believe it.
And they've created their own monster. And their prior politicians, their prior economists have created this monster that believes it. And if you're not up there believing it as well, they're going to vote for somebody else because you're just crazy. Okay, and so there's enough people like that. It doesn't have to be every voter, but it's enough to make the difference between who gets elected and who doesn't. I think a few people in here have tried running for office, campaigning, you know, on an MMT position, and I'm sure they come up against that all the time. Jim Sturgeon told a story, I think it was Jim, maybe Randy, about he had a student who came up to him and said, look, I have to drop out of your class. He goes, why? He said, because You said yesterday we went off the gold standard in 1971 or something. When I told my husband, he said, no, that's ridiculous. You can't go back to that class anymore. So she had to, was that you or is that Jim? It's Jim Sturgeon, yeah. Okay, so you're up against a mindset that's been created, and the politicians don't fight the mindset. They go with it most of the time. You could they're to be expected to go with it. They're not the kind that buck the mindset, or they wouldn't be there. You know, that's what's got them there. That's one of the problems, and it's one of the strengths of our political system. They reflect the will of the people.
So, Warren, the Green Party, which, you know...
Oh, but the first question?
Oh, I'm sorry.
The first part of your question, Social Security.
Social Security for us.
Okay, yeah. So, you know, the way I explain it, and I don't know if it'll work, but look, how do you get your Social Security check? You look at your TV screen, you've got $2,000 in your account, and all of a sudden you've got $4,000. The monitor changes from $2,000 to $4,000. What happens? The government just changes the number on your screen from $2,000, from a 2 to a 4. Okay, they didn't take a gold coin and hit it in, or somebody's tax money and bring it in. They just changed your number up. And when you pay a Social Security tax, your employer, they just change your number down. Okay, so that number they changed up doesn't come from anywhere, you know, any more than the score in a football game comes from anywhere. You kick a field goal, you get 3 points. Where does it come from? It doesn't come from. And they change your number down. They don't get anything. There's no gold coin dropping into a bucket. The Social Security Trust Fund is a ledger that keeps track of what they did. It's an accounting of what happened. It's not the money. They're just accounting. It's a record keeping where when they pay you, they change the number down. And when somebody, when this guy makes this number smaller, they make this number larger. You know, they take 2,000 out of your account. They make this number 2,000 larger. They pay you 2,000. They make this 2,000 smaller. It keeps track. And when it gets to zero, all that means is they've taken out as much as they've paid out. And then if they pay out more, it goes negative. Doesn't like ring a bell and somebody gets an electric shock. Okay. Now there is a law in Congress that says they need approval to do that. That's a political constraint. It's kind of unthinkable they wouldn't just go through it because they do that all the time. That's like the debt ceiling, right? So it's not a law that doesn't that's any kind of binding thing. But so I don't know if any of that imagery helps.
Oh, I understand it completely.
Yeah.
We just don't understand why our representatives are allowing and why, you know, Social Security isn't even paying out enough for people.
Well,
so struggling with that.
So what's that quote about that I saw today about people are reluctant to do things that affect their livelihood? Mm-hmm. How's that go? Somebody?
I would think it would be popular, though. If politicians said, hey, yeah, I'm going to take care of you,
yeah,
that would be get them reelected.
Right. So look at Bernie Sanders against Hillary Clinton. Well, he's Santa Claus. You know, it's childish. I'm the adult in the room. We're going to be responsible. We know how this works. Okay, what happens? You know, you'd think, but I mean, not that no one voted for Sanders, but he didn't win. Okay, and maybe he didn't win because she bought all the superdelegates. Yeah, yeah.
Yeah. We're going to have less money, so we can give it to you later on.
Yeah.
And that's what people fight.
Yeah. Yeah, right, right. And one of my other proposals is just to raise Social Security to a minimum of $2,000 a month. You know, yeah, yeah. There's no reason not to. They worry about moral hazard when you give people money, they won't work. But, you know, if you're 70 years old, if you know when you're 30 that when you're 70 you're going to get $2,000 a month, so you're not going to work, I don't think so. That doesn't make any sense. So raising Social Security doesn't carry the moral hazard issue. Now, let me tell you something about my proposals. In 2010, I was proposing this payroll tax holiday. And did I tell you the Fox News story, or was that in the last session? Okay, I can't remember anymore. It actually got to Troy Nash was a grad student here. And one of his buddies was this kid, I think his name was Ricky Love or something, who was President Obama's personal assistant. And he got to Obama with it, and he liked the idea. So, and they actually passed it in 2010. It went into effect in 2011. Not the whole tax, but they cut 2%, which was about 1% of GDP, no, 0.5%. Anyway, it was enough to support the economy for the next 2 years, and the economy didn't cost them the election. And then in 2013, they just let it expire. It was $150 billion increase. Yeah, it was 1% of GDP. It was a big number. So I was hoping for 5% of GDP. But anyway, And it was the only legislation, it's my understanding, passed by the Obama administration on a bipartisan basis in the entire 8 years. Okay, so these are bipartisan things we're dealing with. My last paper on the job guarantee, which I called the transition job, proposed a transition job for Europe, funded by the European Union, okay, secured by tax credits from the individual government, so they didn't have to show negative capital at the ECB. And it's managed by the central bank as a additional tool for price stability. And we showed econometrically or whatever how they, in their own report, showing that the interest rate hasn't been all that good of a tool for price stability, particularly on the downside, and that we showed how this tool would improve price stability in the European Union so they could meet their 2% target or whatever it was. And it was published in a Journal of Economic Models or something, which is a leading mainstream journal. Okay, so these ideas are not heterodox, okay, the way they are. They're not. They're mainstream ideas properly packaged. Not that the mainstream will accept them all, but there's nothing in them that's not mainstream. Okay, I had something this morning, somebody was talking about investment in interest rates, and there was this, you know, the new view versus the old view, where the old view is based on fixed exchange rates. The new view is on today's floating exchange rates. We have a different regime. It doesn't make the old ones wrong. They're just in a different context. And you can look at most of the mainstream models and show, you can disagree with assumptions, but you can also show that some of them are in fixed exchange rate context. It should be floating. Some of them don't include the currency, which is a monopoly, but they would all agree that a monopoly would have effects X, Y, and Z, like unemployment. That's their main argument against monopoly. Well, once they recognize the currency is a monopoly, there's your unemployment, which is what we're talking about, right? A single supplier, price setter. So these things are ready to go. They're ready to go, and they're not at odds with anyone else's saying once you put them in context. Yeah.
Okay. What do you think the pros and cons would be of you or some of your distinguished colleagues writing up the job guarantee and the MMT idea for sort of the elite magazines like The Atlantic and Harper's and all, just to get the idea out there among the sort of liberal elite?
Yeah. Everybody's trying to give me more work. Any other ideas? I'm 68 years old. Jeez.
3,000-word essay, 2,500-word
essay from Really? Yeah. Well, you know, one thing, if anybody does it, which would be a good idea, please run it by me. So first, just to make sure, just to do a quick check to make sure it's nothing we later have to have to answer to, you know, have to explain, because that's happened before also. But no, that's a very good idea. You know who gets published in The Atlantic is Tom Paley. Somebody who's a harsh critic, totally unjustified. The stuff he says, you know, is silly. You know. But anyway, he gets published in The Atlantic. But yeah, no, that's a good idea. You know, I don't know how you do that.
So Warren, I think the hardest thing for us to face down is the concept of the public-private Federal Reserve.
Yeah.
We've got libertarians fighting us with this. We've got Green Party and other folks on the left that have been infected by the Alex Jones virus. And then we've got the independents, which make up, you know, what, 43% of the electorate. So when we go out there to talk, you've got the Green Party that actually has codified it into their platform. But they want to end the Fed.
Yeah.
And while they may not be a viable political party at this point, the people that are in there are sympathetic to our causes. They've just been extremely misled by horrific economic myths and legends. How can we... I mean, I know the answers, but they're not short.
Yeah.
And so because they're not short, within 5 minutes I've lost their attention unless I'm out there dropping the elbow of truth or yelling at them. You know, and that seems to be the only way I keep their attention.
Yeah.
There's got to be an easier, softer way to making the point of the public-private aspect of the Federal Reserve and how people don't need to die for their fetish, as we like to say. You know,
Fetish? No pun intended.
Exactly. If you could talk a little bit about maybe simplifying, I mean, Randy was on with me a couple times and gave a great response. Rohan gave a tremendous response. Unfortunately, none of them were as succinct as you tend to make these points.
Yeah.
They're all genius, but for the layperson, they heard a bumper sticker or slogan at the fireside and they're Birkenstocks while they're smoking hemp.
Yeah, yeah.
And they literally have no concept of the Federal Reserve. Can you talk to that for a second?
Well, when I used to visit the Fed, I tried to get them to do it. You know, just for public information, why don't you let people know? And Bernanke said it when he was asked. He said, we take our marching orders from Congress. So you have that, but they don't believe it. And it's all this conspiracy theory stuff. There's a lot of it. You know, and after that, they'll tell you the World Trade Center was demolition and we never went to the moon and all. Maybe we didn't. I don't know. But, you know, but it seems to be like all part of the same thing, right? And there's going to be people like that. I guess it's going to take someone from credible in their minds explaining it. And we're not credible in their minds to explain it. So we can say things like, look, all the profits go to the Treasury. All the officers are appointed by the president, approved by Congress, and they're controlled entirely by the Federal Reserve Act. Say, it looks like government to me, you know. And then I have the advantage of saying, look, I owned a bank, and I own shares in the Fed, and it was just a bank deposit. There's no ownership or interest or anything paid. They just paid me a flat 6% interest on my $100,000 or whatever it was. And never called me once about policy, or anything. You know. And so, but everybody can't say that. I mean, I can say that, but because I did. But so I have firsthand experience, and yeah, I mean, it's definitely an obstacle. And you should say that. You should start off like, say, look, this is a major obstacle. The same people saying this are saying these other things. You know, the chairman of the Federal Reserve has said he. You know, it's all federally controlled. It's the Federal Reserve Act, Congress that controls them. They're federal regulators that regulate, when they come in and regulate the banks. All the profits go to the government. If it was private, why would all the profits, not some of the profits? There are no you know, and so, but you can start off by saying, yeah, that's a tough one because, you know, everybody who believes in a conspiracy theory doesn't want to hear anything, no matter what I say. So when you start with that, you can usually get a little more attention. You know, because they don't want to be one of those, even though they are of the worst kind. But you know, and there's a page on the internet that debunks that just explains exactly what I said from some authority that you could copy print, you know, to give to people. It's on the net. I remember seeing it. I remember who it was from, but it was a very definitive thing from a credible source.
One statement real quick and then one question. The biggest thing that we need to get past is fear of the federal deficit just for the average person. So I try to do that daily, as many as they listen to me after listening to all of you. And the other thing that, the question that I had that I can't answer is, if we implement the things that we would like to do with our knowledge of MMT, the federal job guarantee and other things, how will this affect the international markets? And I have no idea how to answer that question or if it's even a valid question, but people ask me.
Yeah, okay, so what I like to start with is, okay, so let's say we do this and we have good jobs for everybody and a good economy, you know, good public infrastructure, good health care, people can send their kids to school, they can, you know, have a nice place to live. Like, what do you care about the world? What do you care? Why, you know, why would something happening over in some other country worry you at that point, prevent you from doing this? Okay, so they're worried about international capital markets. You say, well, why would price changes of stocks or bonds in markets overseas make? Why would we care about that? You know, what would the importance be as long as we have all these other things? Do you have an investment in some bonds in China or something that you're asking me about? You know, where's this question coming from? You know, how would this affect the polar ice cap or something? Well, do you have some stake in the polar ice cap? Because I'll look it up, but it's not. Oh, so will this cause the dollar to go down? Okay, so you ask, okay, if you get a good job and you're making good money, and you can afford nice things, a nice place to live, sending your kids to school, dressing them, and, you know, why the fact that it buys fewer euro or more euro, why does that bother you? So maybe you're saying the price of a European vacation might go higher?
Yeah.
Okay, well, and you say, okay, well, that's true, but that could happen anyway. The euro just went up 20% with what we have. Okay, the dollar has gone down before by 30, 40% with what we have. Those markets fluctuate, you know, for whatever reason, and you say, I'll bet you didn't even know that happened. And if you went to Europe and things cost, you know, $12 instead of $10, it probably wouldn't have made that big a difference to you. It's just not the first order importance of what we're concerned about, you know, and it's just as likely to go the other way. Nobody can predict foreign exchange markets. You know, it might be $8 next time or $12 the next time. That's always going to be the case. If you're going to go on a trip to Europe, the value of that euro could be anywhere. And they could change, their prices could change. And a lot of it, most of it depends on their policy, not ours. So, yeah. Does that help? Okay. But always point out first, look, here's what the world's going to look like here. Now, what was that question again? Yeah. Yeah.
Warren, hi. In the spirit of sound bites, and
yeah.
also checking in with you to see if I'm doing the right thing,
yeah.
I use this line all the time. Tell me if this is the right metaphor. I say the reason you don't see an unemployed fish is because there's no taxation authority. Am I correct?
Yeah, because the fish don't have tax liabilities. is Paul still here? Okay, he wrote that in the introduction to full employment and price stability. He used a school of fish as an example.
Oh, is that right?
Yeah. There's no unemployment in nature. There's no unemployment in non-monetary societies. You go to an Indian tribe, or you go to Africa before the British went in, or you go to a military. There's never unemployment. Everybody's doing something. A sheep station in Australia out in the back. There's no unemployment. If they bring in a tractor, there's suddenly brothers sitting around doing nothing. No, everybody's doing something. Okay, but you impose a tax. Now there's unemployment. It's always a monetary phenomenon. Unemployment is the monetary phenomenon that we're concerned about.
Just one comment, though. You know, with all this discussion, it's Social Security, et cetera. You know, we'll never run out of money. If it's problem inflation, the onus is on them to prove it.
Yeah.
Got it. But it actually stops there instead of going further, in which case you can really make some policy issues here. So the one way you will get inflation out there is if you've got, you know, a certain amount of elderly but no caregivers. Now suddenly there's an inflation in caregiving prices. So in some sense, this actually goes further in the sense that you can actually set up policy.
Right, but if there's, if you can have a bottleneck, but if if you encourage more robots and more productivity, it just frees up people to do all that. You know, and so, and that's presumably in all these long-term inflation forecasts. It's already in there. You know? So now the other thing is, you know, well, what happens if you overspend? Well, the inflation, you know, you might get inflation. And so how do you score a program? Okay, well, let's score Medicare for All, send it to the CBO and see how it changes. No tax. Let's see how it changes their inflation forecast. I'm pretty sure it'll either stay the same or go down, right? In which case, you don't have to do anything. I haven't scored it. I'm pretty sure it will. Now, people are going to have a lot more money, but most of it's going to get saved because right now there's a starve for savings because we've had chronic underfunding of pension funds and all kinds of savings and financial assets to the point of Steve was talking about. People don't have enough money to even get to the next paycheck, so they're taking out payday loans. So, it's, you know, initially it's going to be filling up the savings, and then maybe at some point, who knows, down the road, you get a tenth or two inflation if you don't adjust the spending. I don't even think you will then. The savings is, the productivity increase is so enormous on the supply side because you're going to get, you know, 50% more. Those people, you're going to displace $500 billion worth of people earning salaries to do something else, which will have supply side effects. And so it's like you've got $500 billion that's being spent to have people dig holes and fill them in, and now they're going to be doing something more productive. And so that's a huge deflationary effect also. So I can't see anything but deflation from everything except some balances will go up. But I see all the real-world effects of it as massively deflationary.
All right, due to time constraints, we're going to end it there. And thank you, Warren.
Okay, welcome back. Thanks for watching Warren Mosler, The Story of Money. What did you think? Please tell us in the comments. What are your thoughts on this? How did you come to this video? What level of knowledge did you have? Did someone show you this for the first time? You know, are you new to the idea of economics at all? Are you new to the MMT? Do you have an economic background? Talk to us. Who are you? What did you think of what you just saw? My takeaway is a government that creates its own currency has multiple constraints upon itself and what it can and cannot do, but none of them, not a single one, has anything at all to do with how much money it's going to take. I'm sorry, we can't afford it. That's not how it works. Warren Mosler just took us through the whole process. And next week, we're going to be bringing more economic experts. There are constraints. Do we have enough labor to be able to perform whatever it is we want to do? Do we have enough raw materials to do whatever it is we want to do? But we always, always have enough money. The financing is the easiest part. It is the part we don't have to spend any time discussing if we understand how the monetary system works. But we don't, so we have to discuss it because people are dying. I hope you share this video. I hope it spurs conversations. People have always asked me, you know, if you could ask for one thing, would it not be for single-payer healthcare? Because they know I'm in healthcare and that's what I advocate for. And I say, no, if I could ask for only one thing, I want people to understand the monetary system, how it actually functions. Because it's the misunderstanding of how it actually functions that is leading people to their deaths. It is allowing oligarchs to be able to take everything for themselves and then make sure that we don't even bother standing up for ourselves because they have made us believe that, I'm sorry, there's just not enough money left over. That's not the way it works. Please enlighten your friends. And we'll be back next week. Talk to you later. Bye-bye.